What's going on, family? Last week we talked about soul ties for our new segment called Theology Thursday, and this week we are going to dive into generational curses. Believe it or not, the concept of soul ties and the concept of a generational curse are very, very similar. What both ideas are saying are that there are invisible forces linking me to other people. A soul tie is saying that there are invisible forces linking me to people that I may have been sexually active with, or I may have been intimate with at a soul level. And what a generational curse is saying is that there are invisible forces linking me to my parents or to my grandparents or to my great-grandparents. Now, I defended soul ties a little bit, but I am going to kind of attack generational curses. But before I attack it, I just want to let everybody know that these videos, that Theology Thursdays, are brought to you by Arma Courses. For $11 a month, you can explore topics like this. So last week, I filmed an IGTV video just about soul ties, and then Aaron and I, my co-creator, the other founder of Arma Courses, we filmed a 60-minute video that's exclusively available to people who are subscribers on the Arma Courses platform. So that's my commercial for Arma. I think that it is gold. For $11 a month, you can educate yourself and get a theological education, which I think is necessary for every single Christian, so that we can think through ideas like generational curses, like soul ties, so that we can hear things from the pulpit and know whether or not we're being duped, whether or not we're being manipulated, so that we can know whether or not what someone's preaching is actually biblical. So I want to tell you guys a narrative, a story. We're going to talk about Abraham, his son Isaac, his grandsons Jacob and Esau, and then his great grandsons. We're going to particularly talk about Joseph. So we're going to talk about four generations, and we're going to talk about how one character trait finds its way throughout almost every generation of that family. If you remember, there's a story in Genesis chapter 20. Genesis chapter 20, it's probably familiar to a lot of people. But I just want to, it's not the most popular story, but in Genesis chapter 20, Abraham finds himself with a king named Abimelech, king of Gerar, okay? And he lies about whether or not his wife is actually his sister, okay? He tells the king that his wife is actually his sister. This is Genesis chapter 20. God is not pleased with this. In a dream, he lets the king know not to do anything sexual with Abraham's wife, because it is not just his sister, but it is his wife. But here's what's interesting. In Genesis chapter 26, Isaac, Abraham's son, once Abraham is dead, and I mean, Isaac wasn't even alive when Abraham pulled this little trick. It says that Isaac went to Abimelech, king of the Philistines in Gerar. Same king, same town, same city. And the Lord appeared to Isaac and said, "Do not go down to Egypt. Live in the land where you are to live. Stay here for a little while, and I'll bless you." And it says this: when the men of that place asked him about his wife, he said, "She is my sister," because he was afraid to say, "She is my wife." He thought the men of this place might kill me on account of Rebekah, because she is beautiful. Now, what's crazy is that his father Abraham said the same exact words to the same exact group of people in the same city to the same king a generation prior. And so we have a generational trait, a generational lie, a generational habit, a generational sin that manifests itself now in generation number two. And I wish it stopped there, but that's not where it stops. Isaac has two boys, Jacob and Esau. And now Isaac and his wife Rebekah name one of those boys liar, deceiver, supplanter. So Jacob is now named a liar. So I want you to track with this. What started out with a decision with Abraham now becomes a generational habit with the second generation, Isaac, which now becomes a person. Rebekah gives birth to deception, to a deceiver. See, when generational habits are left unchecked, they grow, they morph, they gain more power and more strength. And here's the actual, this is the craziest part. Let's get to generation number four. Jacob, who lives his entire life tricking people, deceiving people, finally God changed his name to Israel. However, he's already had all these sons, okay? Remember, the 12 tribes of Israel are started by the 12 sons of Jacob. And what happens with these sons? Well, one day, Joseph gets attacked by these boys. And his royal robe is stripped from him. They slaughter an animal. They put the blood of that animal on the robe and they bring it back to their father, Jacob. And now we have multiple sons all lying and saying that their brother is dead when really they sold their brother into slavery. So what started with Abraham as a decision turns into a generational cycle or habit with his son. And then when it gets to Jacob, it's his identity. I mean, he's just known as a liar. He's known as a deceiver. And then what happens? Jacob, the man who's known for lying or for deceiving, is deceived by his own sons. And the deception is against their brother, Joseph. Now, Joseph is where I want to land. Because Potiphar's wife says to Joseph, hey, look at you. You mighty fine. You're pretty cute. Hey, you can sleep with me. No one will know. Now, lying is in this boy's DNA. Lying is in Joseph's generational, it's in his generational ancestry pool. Lying should come naturally to Joseph. But Joseph would rather go to prison and have his integrity. And Joseph chooses integrity. If generational curses were true, then Joseph would have been doomed to repeat a generational curse that had been in his family for four generations. What's my problem with the word curse? My problem with the word curse is it is too fatalistic. Now, I believe in generational trauma, generational cycles, generational sin, generational habits. I would even go as far as to say that I believe in generational strongholds. I believe in generational patterns. But do I believe that Joseph was cursed? No. And I don't believe that anyone is cursed. I think to use the language of cursing is actually hermeneutically inaccurate. It's theologically irresponsible. I do not believe that anyone is cursed. Here's why I don't believe anyone is cursed. Let's go to the book of Galatians. We can go to the book of Galatians. We're actually gonna go to Galatians chapter 3. Galatians chapter 3, and we're gonna read verse 13. Galatians chapter 3, verse 13. It says this: Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who is hung on a tree. Now, why don't I believe in generational curses? I don't believe in generational curses because whatever curse was in your family line, it stops at the foot of the cross. My dad served an 18-year prison sentence. My dad has been an addict my whole life. But I don't believe that an addict's blood is running through my veins. I believe that the blood of Jesus is running through my veins. And the moment someone says that they're cursed, now they have an excuse as to why they cannot change, as to why they cannot transform, as to why they feel like they have to keep making the decisions that their father or their mother or their grandfather or their grandmother or their aunts or their uncles made. Are there generational patterns? Yes. Are there generational cycles? Yes. Are there generational sins? Yeah. Generational strongholds? For sure. Generational dysfunction? It's very, very real. Generational trauma? 100%. But a curse? No, you're not cursed. And no New Testament believer is cursed. And Joseph, who was in the Old Testament, was not cursed. Joseph made the decision. My brothers are liars. My dad is a liar. My grandfather's a liar. And my great-grandfather was a liar. But I'm different. And Joseph chose integrity. And if Joseph can choose integrity, if I can choose to not be an addict like my dad, if I can make those decisions, if Joseph can make those decisions, then you are empowered to be the first person in your family to not be incarcerated, to be the first person in your family to be an entrepreneur, to be the first person in your family that doesn't have diabetes, to be the first person in your family that's not in debt. Whatever that looks like, you have the power to make different decisions. You are not cursed. And so I do not agree with the rhetoric of generational curses. Because, as we find out in the book of John, and I'm pretty sure this is John chapter 3. In John chapter 3, Jesus has a conversation with a man by the name of Nicodemus. And when Jesus has a conversation with a man by the name of Nicodemus, he says this to Nicodemus. And I'm going to find it for us. And I'm pretty sure it's John chapter 3. Yes, it is. Here we go. Jesus says to Nicodemus in John chapter 3, verse 3, in reply, Jesus declared, I tell you the truth, no one can see the kingdom of God unless he is born again. Nicodemus is confused. He says, how can a man be born again when he is old? Nicodemus asked, surely he cannot enter a second time into his mother's womb. I want to let you know this, that you're not judged by your first birth. You're judged by your rebirth. The reason that when we come into the kingdom, we're born again is because, come on, some of us, we were just born into a family that was very, very dysfunctional. And when I got born again, I couldn't use my first birth or the situation or the predicament surrounding my first birth as any excuse as to why I could not live out the Christian life that God had called me to live. God held me responsible to my identity based on my rebirth, not all of the setbacks that I may have inherited in my first birth. So I invite you to be born again. I invite you to maybe create a different path or a different future for the generations following you. I don't believe in generational curses. I do believe in generational trauma, and I do believe that it's your responsibility to heal. It may not be your fault that you've inherited all this baggage, but it is your responsibility to create a new future for yourself, for your children, for your children's children, and for your children's children's children. I love you. I hope that this week's installment of Theology Thursday was helpful to you. Meet me here again next week. Light up the comments. Go follow ARMA courses and maybe even consider subscribing to ARMA or becoming a founder. We believe that theology really is the way forward, that good theology can help the average ordinary Christian. We believe in theology for every Christian. Love you. See you next time. Peace.